Thank you, Professor Safa. Welcome all of you to my talk on future of internal combustion engines and existential threat from battery electric vehicles. So if you look at the world today, you know, there are three main concerns. One is that the petroleum resources that we have are getting depleted very, very fast. And because of these petroleum resources, which we are digging from below the earth, surface, we are putting CO2 into the atmosphere, which is leading to global warming and change of climate. And this is also affecting the urban air quality in most cities in the world. And this needs to be tackled. Now, before we go into the details of BEV and IC engines, it's imperative to look at the petroleum consumption worldwide. So this is a pie chart which shows which are the countries which consume most of the petroleum. For example, United States consumes roughly about 26% of the petroleum of the world. China consumes about 7%. And this is where India is. India is consuming about 2.6% of the global petroleum. Now, if you compare India with US, we have four times larger population compared to US, and we are consuming 10 times lesser petroleum. That means on a per capita basis, we are consuming 40 times less per capita energy consumption per year. Okay, so there is, we can't afford to spend the same kind of energy which USA and Europe does, or many developed countries do. Let's look at the motorization growth that is expected. And this is the reference, and this is a journey between 2000 to 2050. This bottom line is for America and Europe. So pretty much the number of cars that are used in both of these places is somewhere between 700 to 900 per 1,000 people. Whereas in India, the penetration of the motorization is still 15 to 17 cars per 1,000 people. So going forward, the growth in motorization will happen in this zone. As you can see, that China, the number of vehicles is going to increase phenomenally. Asian countries, including India, is also going to see a lot of growth. So that means that in going forward in next 30 to 40 years, Asia will be center of growth of the global economy driven by motorization in the world. But you know that when we talk about motorization, there are many dangers as well. And recently we remember that there was an event happened, which is infamously known as Dieselgate. And there were some manipulation on how the emissions were measured. And that was really a triggering point where people motivated to write obituaries about diesel engines. And this was really the dark phase in the history of internal combustion engines. Internal combustion engines have served the mankind for last 130 years now. And in fact, they have powered the mankind to today's level of development in every economic activities they have played an extremely important role. So after this Dieselgate, IC engines are tagged as one of the prime culprits for increasing global CO2 emissions. They are touted as the dirtiest machines. And people have said that, you know, they have good run, but the end, their end is in sight. And many believe that, you know, IC engine technology has nearly saturated and there is hardly any scope for further research and development. And in this talk, we will evaluate all these facts, whether really has IC engine reached the level of saturation that we think, that many, many people say that it has reached. So question that is being asked is it the dead end for the IC engines? And that is what we are going to critically examine in this talk. So let's look at some of the myths versus the realities. So around, the Toyota Motors, in 2020 beginning, they said, you know, they announced massive electric offensive, and they said that, you know, this is going to be death of IC engines. But later on, the narrative has changed, And then they said that electrification doesn't mean the death of IC engines. So slowly, you know, in the beginning, in the automotive industry worldwide, there was a big response for going forward with battery electrification. But the big companies slowly realized that that's probably not the right thing, and they changed the course. If you look at the transport, you know, transport is very central to the modern society. And most people who say that, you know, battery electric vehicle is the solution probably do not understand the extent of problem. So globally, you know, transport sector accounts for 14% of GHG emissions, 14 to 16%, and 20% of the energy use, and they contribute about 23% of the CO2 emissions to the atmosphere. So 77% CO2 emission does not come from transport sector, they come from other sectors. Which ones? I will just show you. Currently, you know, there are 1.2 billion cars available in the world, global roads, 1.2 billion. And there are more than 350 billion commercial vehicles, million commercial vehicles on the roads. People are just trying to think about this part only, and there's hardly any effort to look at commercial vehicles electrification. Light duty vehicles, they account for 44% of the global transport energy demand. And mostly this transport sector is driven by liquid fuels because they have very high energy density. They are easy to transport, they are easy to store, there is extensive infrastructure, and people are very comfortable handling the liquid fuels at every place in the world. Now let's look at how much fuel we consume every day. So if you look at the fuel that is consumed, roughly about 4.9 billion liters of gasoline and diesel and 1.2 billion liters of jet fuel is consumed every day to sustain the transport sector in the world. So let's just convert this into the energy that we need. So when we convert into energy form, this is about 105 terawatt hour of energy that is needed just to sustain the transport sector in the world. Now, just to put these numbers in perspective, we have to look at the capacity. So in India, now we have about 365 gigawatt hour capacity. So this is really a very, very large number, large amount of energy that is consumed worldwide. And this demand for transport energy is growing roughly about 1% per year in most non-OECD countries. And then this petroleum and transports are very, very closely interlinked. For example, 90% of the transport energy comes from petroleum, and 60% of the petroleum product goes as transport fuel. So this is the relationship between the transport and petroleum industry. Now, as I said, you know, many people believe that most of the GHG emissions are coming from transport sector, primarily from the buses and trucks. This is a complete, grossly incorrect misconception. This table shows you where the GHG emissions are coming from different sectors. And as you can see, about 45 to 50% is coming from energy sector. Then there is agriculture contributing a large chunk. Then there is a land use, some comes from forestry. And then there is a small chunk, about 15, 16% coming from transport. Then there's residential and commercial sector, industry sector, and other sources. So as you can see, even if you throttle this 15% and bring it down to zero, which is virtually impossible, you will still have problem to deal with. This problem of the GHG emission is not going to go away. So let's now look at the solution that is being given in the form of electric vehicles and the challenges that it poses to IC engines and petrochemical industry. So let's look at some of the advantages of electric vehicles, which are sort of perceived by people at large and also marketed by battery electric vehicle enthusiasts. And let's examine them very, very critically. So one is that it is said that it is carbon neutral and it is zero pollution. It is said that it is less noise pollution, which is true to some extent. Then it is said that it is energy efficient because electrical vehicles have efficiency in the range of 59 to 60% between grid power and power at wheels, whereas their poor IC engine cousins only have efficiency of 28 to 35% efficiency. This is the energy of the gasoline to the power at wheels. But this is a sort of an unfair comparison because you have to start with cradle to grave, and once you put the efficiency at which coal is burned and it is converted to electricity plus the transmission and distribution losses, this vehicle of the efficiency, electric vehicle efficiency, will be somewhere between 18 to 20% in India. So this will look far worse than the IC engines as of now. The other point that is said is lesser cost of charging that we will see, and I will have some data to show this. And then, you know, there are some performance benefits like smooth operation, strong acceleration. And it is also said that, you know, battery electric vehicles have less maintenance requirement. You don't need to change the filter. There is no need for any exhaust gas after treatment. And it reduces the energy dependence. Some of them are true, but most of them are not. So let's look at this cleanliness thing. So diesel engine, of course, you can see that smoke is coming out. So possibly some people think that is dirty. Whereas battery electric vehicle, the electricity is coming from the power plant, which is burning coal in most countries. And then, you know, it looks very clean because you don't have any CO2 emission coming out. As I said, you know, as far as CO2 emissions are concerned, most people try to compare the efficiency from electricity to the power at wheel. Whereas once they do the CO2 emissions and efficiency calculations, it will be appropriate to include the CO2 put during mining, transportation, energy generation, and during usage. So once you put this completely, the story changes completely. Then you see there are some countries which have already reserved the nickel and cobalt mines all over the world. So essentially, you know, this is going to lead to dependence on those countries. And then, you know, these are some of the famous photographs that you see about that, you know, many of the battery electric vehicle owners have to carry the diesel generators in case they run out of the juice when they are going for a drive. This is a Raygon diagram, which compares the volumetric energy density of a fuel to the gravimetric energy density. And obviously we would like to be as far away from the origin as possible. So these are the points where diesel and gasoline is, and this is where the lithium-ion battery is. The best lithium-ion batteries that we have about 1.5 megajoule per kilogram of weight. That is the best state of the art that is available. So if you compare the battery energy, 1 kilogram gasoline has energy equivalent of about 30 megajoule. And for storing this in the batteries, you will require 26 lithium ion batteries, which will be weighing about 26 kilograms and which will be having a volume of 75.6 kilograms. So gasoline actually is almost a perfect fuel for as far as the volumetric energy density and gravimetric energy density is concerned. Now, this, you know, if you look at this table here, all the fuels that are used in transport sector are actually listed. And here you can see that this column shows the energy density. So for example, hydrogen has 142 megajoule per kilogram. Gasoline is about 46.8 megajoule per kilogram. Coal is about 27. And this is the CO2 that comes out for, you know, the kilojoule per mole of CO2 that is coming out. And if you look at this, the best batteries that are available are having an energy density between 0.5 to 1.5 megajoule per kilogram. You can compare this. Of course, batteries do not burn, and this fuel gets burned up, you have to refill it. But the fact of the matter is that the weight and the energy density does matter, because you have to carry the batteries as well. And this increases the weight of the vehicle. And for that, the energy is also used. So many countries have realized, and there are many articles in the news that, you know, electric cars are more polluting and gas guzzlers, at least in China. Similarly, in UK, which has gone for full electrification by 2030, there people are questioning this they are asking, is there enough electricity? Do we really have enough electricity? Do we really have enough lithium and cobalt to power the entire UK? People are questioning. There is not enough lithium and cobalt and nickel to power the entire transport sector in UK. Similarly, you know, people say that it is very clean, but these are the working conditions in the mines, cobalt mines in Congo, where, you know, children as small as 10 years, 15 years do the mining, and their average lifetimes are reduced to about 20 years because of the hazardous working conditions, so that we, all of us, can drive clean cars. Coming to the cost, these are three different reports by three different groups which compare the GHG emissions between compact IC engine cars and compact battery electric vehicles. Similarly, they have compared the mid-size IC engine vehicle with mid-size battery electric vehicle. And most of them conclude that yes, the CO2 emissions are low, but they are not CO2 free. So if you take into account everything, compared to IC engine vehicles, they emit about 20% less CO2 into the atmosphere. So this is one positive aspect of battery electric vehicle. When the cost was compared, and the cost included the cost of battery, the cost of running, cost of electricity, cost of recycling, everything was put together. Then it turned out that the IC engine vehicles and battery electric vehicle, the battery electric vehicle per kilometer ownership cost was about 44% higher. In the mid-size SUV segment, the cost of battery electric vehicle was about 60% higher. And when we compare this impact on the life from the toxicity that is generated by the pollutants, it turns out that the battery electric vehicle is three times more potential. So their human toxicity potential is three times greater. And so this is not as clean as it looks like. Some people have compared this Model S of Tesla with BMW 7 Series and Mitsubishi Mirage. And they have compared the emissions of CO2 during production. So here you can see that even compared to BMW, Tesla actually during the production stage emit lots and lots of CO2 into the atmosphere. During usage, you know, the emissions are lower, but they are comparable to a small car. End of the life emissions, recycling stage also. So the life cycle emissions are close to 60,000 kilograms of CO2 for Tesla put over a lifetime of 270,000 kilometers. Whereas BMW was more, but the Mirage, the small car, was less. So per kilometer basis, this is 226 grams, 385 grams for BMW, and 190 grams for Mitsubishi Mirage. This calculation to a large extent depends on how a country is generating the power. Say, for example, this curve actually shows how a country is generating the power. For example, you know, how much is coming from coal, how much is being generated from oil, nuclear, wind, solar, everything is put together. So if you look at India, which is here, in India, 82% of the power comes from burning the coal. So obviously, when we put this electricity into the battery electric vehicle, this is going to emit 370 grams per kilowatt per kilometer CO2 into the atmosphere. Whereas there are countries which have CO2-free energy sources, so obviously it will make a lot of sense. Their battery electric vehicles are going to be relatively cleaner. So the point that I'm trying to make is that how much CO2 will be put into the atmosphere in a particular geographical region, it depends on how you are generating the power. If it is coal dominated, if it is based on hydrocarbons, then, you know, the emissions are going to be much higher. There are a few other challenges which are faced by battery electric vehicles. For example, they have very large battery for large range, and that will increase the weight as well as size. They have very long charging times. They have very high initial cost. I mean, the cheapest electric vehicle that is available in India is three times more expensive compared to the same size IC engine car. And battery life is still a problem, although there are guarantees, but nobody knows whether it will really work that way or not. So the consumer acceptance is just not there, I can tell you, at least in India. With great difficulty, 1,000 cars have been sold and people are very unhappy about them. Grid integration of the battery electric vehicle is also another problem. And I can tell you that once the BEV plan of India, because we have also decided that we will go 30% by 2030. So once that happens, the battery waste is going to be immense problem. And then, you know, in India, this water logging is a big problem on the roads. When monsoons come, many of our roads get flooded. And in that situation, we don't know how the battery electric vehicle is going to play out. There have been many, many incidents where suddenly, you know, the battery electric vehicles catch fire and it can be really catastrophic at times. There are a lot of concerns related to electric shock. There are a lot of concerns related to battery acid, short circuits. What will be the effect on people who are having pacemakers because you are sitting inside a strong magnetic field? What happens when battery damage takes place or the accident takes place? What happens to the battery storage? So all these things are something which are still not totally accepted by people. So India has decided to go for 30% electrification by 2030, which is about 10 years from now. So let us look at how it is going to happen or why it is going to happen and whether it is really a risk for, I mean, death of IC engine and so on. So if you look at this 2020, we have 2018, you know, this is 2018 data. We had about 4 million cars in the road. Now, if we take at the rate at which the growth of transport sector is happening, by 2030, we will be having about 10 million cars. So in 10 years, we will be from 4 million to 10 million. So 30% of that is 3 million. So even if we achieve this impossible task of 3 million cars in electric, the growth in IC engine based cars will be from 4 million to 7 million, which is a strong growth of 70%. So certainly, I mean, even if we achieve the target of 30% electrification, this is not going to be death of IC engine. IC engines will be growing at a rate of 70% over 10 years, which is a very, very healthy growth rate. Now to cater to this 3 million cars in 10 years, you know, we will be required to have 120 gigawatts of hours of battery production. And considering that there will be some battery required for hybrid vehicles, you will be required to have about 140 gigawatt hour of battery manufacturing capability. One gigafactory can produce about 35 gigawatt hour of battery. So that means, we will be required to invest close to $20 billion just to manufacture the batteries. And this does not include the availability of the material, only the battery manufacturing capability. It's going to be a huge hurdle and huge challenge for us. Coming to the materials, you know, three important materials for the batteries are cobalt, lithium, and nickel. And all three of them, the demand will exceed the supply in 2022, 2024, and 2025. And we know that once the demand exceeds the supply, the prices are going to increase. And this is going to be quite challenging to sustain the battery electric vehicle demand. So coming to IC engines and petrochemical industry, you know, engines were invented around 1900 by Rudolf Diesel engines and Nicholas Otto 1890. And since then it has been working and the engine has really gone through all phases of evolution. And at one point in time, it was the vehicle of development of the modern society. And now people are condemning it because it is reportedly rotten. And people are writing obituaries to it. But wait, it's not dead. It's time for IC engine 2.0, where you will see a newer IC engine which will comply with the future. So IC engines are going to evolve in future. And alternative to IC engines or alternative to petroleum-based liquid fuel face very significant barriers for fast adoption. There is ill-informed mischaracterization of combustion, which has led to this belief that it's the death of the IC engine. But you have to understand that fuel economy of the vehicles has improved dramatically. And in next 10 years, at least I can say about spark ignition engines, the efficiency will be increasing by about 50% more. So mileage that you get today, in next 10 to 15 years time, the efficiency will increase by 15%. The mileage will increase because there are many new engine technologies that are coming on our way. For example, now people are looking at this HCCI engine, which is also called low temperature combustion engine, which is a hybrid of SI and CI engine. It's extremely efficient and it's just a matter of time before it becomes commercially available. This engine produces 95 to 98% lower NOx and PM emissions, and it is much more efficient compared to SI and CI engines. And hopefully in next 4 to 5 years time, this should be available commercially. The other thing is that, you know, this PCCI, one of the other technology in the low temperature combustion family is partially premixed controlled compression ignition, which is a very, very important novel systems. And this is something which is going to be much more efficient compared to the existing engines. And the best part is that the IC engine community has understood, has really felt the heat from the battery electric vehicles. And this competition between electric vehicles and IC engine based vehicles is stimulating, you know, beneficial evolution of the internal combustion engine itself. So I consider this competition to be quite good. And now people are exploring at a fundamental level, you know, how So at a fundamental level, you know, there are many, many opportunities which are being explored. And each of this point that you are looking in this table is where the research is going on to refine the engines further and further, including looking at use of the optical engines to understand fundamental processes that are happening, including how the fuel air mixing is happening, including how the pollutants are forming. And once they go out of the tailpipe, how we are going to, you know, control those pollutants and so on. With the development of the SI engines, there will and the diesel engines becoming more and more popular, there will be a lot of gasoline that will be available in the market. And see, when we have taken out most of the oil, the petroleum that is left is heavy. So that means the gasoline fuel will be available in excess, and it will also be poor quality gasoline. So for this, you know, a new technology called gasoline compression ignition is being developed, which will use basically gasoline in fuel in a compression ignition engine. And this technology is also a path-breaking technology. Already one commercial product has been launched by Mazda. And in this, the gasoline will be directly injected in the engine, and this is going to be very, very clean. And the benefits are going to be that, you know, you will be able to use cheaper fuel injection systems, you will be able to use higher compression ratios, which will give you higher thermal efficiency. And you will be using lower octane fuel, as low as 17. So that means you don't have to refine them too much. So refining cost will be lower. So cost of the fuel is going to be lower. And also you will have benefits in terms of lower soot and NOx emissions and lower GHG emissions. And these GCI engines, you know, as far as the efficiency is concerned, they will be more efficient than diesel engines, and their cost will be same as spark ignition engines. And they will actually have lower overall GHG impact compared to 30% better than SI engines. And this will open up a new path to mitigate the demand imbalance between light and heavy fuels, and also for utilizing the low octane number gasoline fuel that will be available in excess in the refineries worldwide. There is a lot of research going on in GCI engine technology, and already the engines having 56% efficiency have been demonstrated in Lund University as well as in Engine Research Center, University of Wisconsin. So this is not something that I'm talking in air. This is demonstrated already, and it's just a matter of time that these products come into the market. There will be additional efficiency improvement compared over and above 56%. And of course, there is always a scope for hybridization. That means you take advantage of the electrical engine technology, electrical motor technology, and IC engine technology. And this will also further improve the mileage from the vehicles that will be available in the road in future. In India, you know, we are looking at methanol economy to power our transport sector. So what we are thinking is that all this low-value agricultural biomass that is available in large quantity, as well as high ash coal, kitchen waste, agriculture waste, all this will be collected and gasified, and you produce carbon monoxide plus hydrogen, which you will convert into methanol, and then methanol can be converted to dimethyl ether, and these can be used for powering various applications, including transport sector, industrial sector, industrial burners, ships, locomotives, and so on. So the government of India is working very, very actively in it, and we are trying to take a leap from China. China already has more than 2 million vehicles running on methanol, and we are trying to implement the similar type of exercise in India. So coming to the end, I will just like to summarize, you know, that global transport energy is large, very, very large, and it is increasing with time. There are different motivations for change in different places. This has to be kept in mind. One size does not fit all, depending on how you are generating electricity. The BEV may make sense or it may not make sense. Alternatives start from a very low base, which are very costly, inconvenient, and cannot grow without constraint. Even by 2020, most of the transport energy will come from petroleum powering the IC engines. Alternatives need to be assessed on a life cycle analysis basis. And this exercise has not been done very, very seriously in different parts of the world. GHG and other impacts of transport can be reduced only by improving the IC engine, and a lot of efforts are going on in this direction. More diesel and jet fuels are needed compared to gasoline, and increase in octane number of the gasoline pool. There are great challenges in the refining technology, and huge investments are required. Therefore, low octane gasoline will make a lot of sense in future. There is great scope for developing highly efficient engines running on such fuels. And then gasoline compression engine and engines having octane on demand will really fulfill this desire. All stakeholders need to work together to bring such optimized fuel engine systems to the market, rather than only developing engines for the existing fuels. And there is increased need of electrification, mostly in the form of hybridization, not in the form of total battery electrification. So hybridization will be welcome and it will have future, but BEV, 100% BEV may not make such sense. Ultimately, in the future, there is no single solution. The future has all technologies. There is scope for all technologies. You cannot say that one fuel, one technology is going to support the entire global transport sector. That will not be a good thing. One editorial for this has been written in International Journal of Engine Research by about 40 researchers from all over the world. The title is The Future of Internal Combustion Engines. This is published in 2020 issue of International Journal of Engine Research, free to download. My request is that whoever is interested, they can download it from there. I would like to give my acknowledgement for this talk to Professor Gautam Kalgatki. Sorry, this is Oxford, not Cambridge. Professor Rajendra Bodia from Clemson University, Jagdish Nanda from Oak Ridge National Laboratory, Koji Taminori from Honda R&D in India, and also International Journal of Engine Research, whose data I have used. Thank you very much. If there are any questions, I'll be happy to answer.